with index cards. We're asking you to please take the index card, write your questions on one side and your contact information on the other side. Then raise your hand, and folks, raise the cue card in the hand, and then somebody will come and collect it from you. If you need one, just keep your hands up. We're hoping you will get the questions in as soon as possible. We will sort them and make sure it gets to the right elected official to answer your question. We're going to have elected officials coming in and out over the course of the evening, and so we'll do so. And I see some strong representation from Westview. Thank you for being here tonight. This is one of the reasons you do this. Just checking with our team. The other important disclaimer, this is being recorded. We post almost everything we do on the internet, so you'll be able to watch it on YouTube, but it also means that the questions that you ask will be recorded, and we're happy to be reading. We will be grouping some of our questions together. And then the other piece is we have a carding company here for ADA accessibility. And I'm just checking in if that person... Okay, so they're over here, and so if you're over there, they're waiting. If you need access to the screen because we only got one request for accommodation this year, whether right or wrong, we only brought one laptop. And so if you need to hear what's going on, you need to read the screen, it's over there. And if you need accessibility, please always reach out to us so we can make sure our events are as accessible as possible. So I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. We do this event every year on Roosevelt Island, and we've been able to get a lot done year in and year out. We're going to be joined tonight by Congressmember Carol Maloney, as well as our Assemblymember Rebecca Seawright. And we already have our State Senator Jose Serrano here. We can give him a quick welcome and round. And we have representatives here from Controller Scott Stringer's office, Public Advocate Tish James's office, and Manhattanboro President Gail Brewer's office. And we know Gail will likely do her best to get here. And so just some thank yous that we've been able to do through these events over the years. We had a problem with 911, and the fact that when you were called 911, they kept asking you, where's the cross street? Well, Roosevelt Island doesn't have any cross streets, so we needed to work with you and 911 and the city, and we were able to get that done with a lot of leadership from the Roosevelt Island Corporation. They are also a sponsor of this evening's event, and I had seen Susan Rosenthal in the audience. She's waving from the back of the room. If we could give Susan a huge round of applause for all the partnerships that they do. They have a public information officer now, so they're starting to get some of the credit for what they do. But I would say it's like the iceberg of the Titanic. You only see a portion of all the hard work React does every day to keep things running. So we're incredibly grateful to that. So I'd like to invite our state senator up if you'd like to make some remarks. And please make sure to get those cards and your questions ready. So, State Senator Serrano is the second longest serving elected official representing Roosevelt Island, just after our Congressmember Carol Maloney, which is not too shabby. Yes, absolutely. He's been fighting for us in the State Senate. And he's done amazing work for us on all cultural arts. He is the reason that there's mobile office towers on Roosevelt Island, because he's been doing them forever. And when I got elected, that was one of his big points. You've got to do this. So I do this. The assembly member also does it. We do it together. It's a lot of fun, but making sure that we bring our offices to you. He represents Roosevelt Island, Upper Manhattan, parts of the Bronx, and he's tremendous ally, and so very much. If you can join me in welcoming our state senator.
Thank you very much, Congressmember Kallos. It's always a pleasure to be with you. You're easily one of the hardest working council members of the city, and I've always enjoyed working with you and with being a representative here on the island. It does go by very quickly. It really feels like just the other day I was elected. I was at the city council before becoming a state senator, and all in all, this is my public office, and it does go by very quickly. And I've said all this many times before, so it may be a tired joke. So if anyone's heard it before, it just laughs, so I don't feel bad. But I was talking yesterday at an event for Mary Fitzgerald at the Senior Center, and I was explaining a little bit how crazy my district is, and how it covers Roosevelt Island, which is such a unique and diverse place, and also the Upper West Side of Manhattan, Central Park, East Harlem, Yorkville, the South and West Bronx. So it is a very weird geographic district, and we wonder why they won't include New Jersey in it, because it is that weird. But I think one of the commonalities throughout all of the different neighborhoods that I represent is that there are basic intrinsic needs for affordability, for ensuring that we have communities that can remain intact and not have residents forced out because of affordability issues when it comes to housing. We all care deeply about public safety. We care deeply about good schools. And we make sure we also care extremely, especially in a place like Roosevelt Island, about transparency in government. I ran as a reformer in government. This was one of the main points and issues that I have worked very hard for in my legislation as it pertains to Roosevelt Island, has always centered around the issues of transparency and having a more inclusive government that focuses a great deal on self-determination and empowering the community here on Roosevelt Island. There are, many different issues and concerns that have been brought up over the years, and I've been very grateful to have such a wonderful staff working with me, and we are on the island every week for our off-site constituent hours. We had some yesterday at the library, so we're either at the Senior Center or at the library. And we do this throughout all the different neighborhoods of my wacky district because we only have one district office, and it's on 130th Street, Park Avenue. It's not the easiest place to get to from Roosevelt Island. So I think it's very important that we set up shop every week on the island so that we can hear firsthand from the constituents, hear about the concerns, but also hear about ideas and suggestions, which we feel are very important as well. With that, I don't want to get too deep into the weeds. I have a lot of notes here, but I want to be able to hear many of the concerns. I see our recently re-elected Congresswoman Carol Maloney is here. Thank you very much. But with that, I will conclude and pass the mic back over to Councilmember Kallos.
Thank you, and our state senator. Yeah, please give him a quick round. Our state senator is one of our co-hosts for this event, and we won't let our congresswoman get too comfortable because we're going to bring her right up to share some remarks. I don't see cards up, so please bring, if you've got your questions, please hold your cards up so our staff can come and get them from you, and please be patient because they will grab them quickly, and we'll be grabbing your questions and making sure we get you answers.
Thank you. I'm so pleased to be here with my colleagues. Thank you, Councilmember, for taking the lead on organizing it, and State Senator Serrano, it's my pleasure to be here to work with you. I literally just got off the plane. I'm coming back from Washington, and I'm so thrilled I could get here tonight. It's been a busy week. We had an election on Tuesday, so that was exciting for me. I had the honor of representing Congress, and the big news of the day was three Supreme Court decisions that underscored how important the Supreme Court is and why it's important to have a Democrat, in my opinion, making appointments. And the big news was Kennedy retired. This will give President Trump another appointment, tilting the court more to the right. And the Supreme Court came down with three, I think, terrible decisions. One is the Janus case at the National Institute of Family Life Advocates versus Becerra, and the Trump versus Hawaii, or the ban, the Muslim, the ban on some entering our country. The Janus ruling will allow those who want to ramp up their efforts to dismantle public sector unions. It's a very strong anti-union decision that will weaken their ability to really gain new members. And the one that the court also overturned a lower court's decision against the medical clinics that seek to trick women looking for reproductive health care. This is actually a bill that I had that ended up in the Supreme Court, and it basically says you have to be truth in advertising. Young women would tell me they would go to, they wanted information about reproductive health care, they'd go to places that had the colors of Planned Parenthood, and yet when they went in, it was a different organization that would tell them that if they were seeking abortion, it's a terrible thing, and in classes and all this kind of thing. And the bill basically said truth in advertising, that you just have to tell them you are. You can't say that you're a pro-life group if you're not. You can't say you're a pro-choice group if you're not. But that, I think, is also a terrible decision, and we're working on passing a different legislation that answers their concerns. And then, of course, the travel ban. This was a very un-American, a ban on many of us think it's bigoted and makes it much harder for refugees fleeing extremist countries to gain refuge in the United States. And worse, yesterday, Kennedy was called a swing vote on the Supreme Court. He used to come down in support of the rights of women and the rights of LGBT and other rights of people. So his loss in the court is a huge loss. So we really do need a Congress that can fight back and pass important individual and civil rights legislation and have a check on other actions that are extremists. I want to tell you that just last week, it was 2 weeks ago, we did a sneak visit or an unannounced visit to one of the penitentiaries for the border retainees. It was in New Jersey. I went over there with some of the New Jersey delegation and some of the New York delegation. We had permission from the people that were in the penitentiary and their attorneys to come in and speak to them. At first, they wouldn't let us in. They started putting paper on the windows so we couldn't even look in. And we said, we have a constitutional right to be here and to go in and see these people. We have our letters of approval. We finally got in to see them. I just want to share it with you. There were five men. All of them had come into the country legally, except for one who said there was violence at the border, so he came in another way and then immediately handed himself in to the authorities. And one of them was fleeing, I can't say their names or the countries, one was fleeing for religious freedom, the other were fleeing for really escaping gang violence. And I'll tell you just one story. This one man, two of the men broke down crying. It's very unusual to see men crying. They were so upset about their children. And one man had his daughter ripped out of his arms at 3 o'clock in the morning. And we and others that had their children removed, they didn't know where they were. They hadn't talked to them. We called the warden in. It was a private financed, it wasn't a public penitentiary. It was a private contracted one for the detainees. And they didn't know where the children were. I've been tracking it. We've asked my colleagues from New Jersey, did they find the children yet? They still haven't found them. So we have several immigration bills. The Democratic one, which I'm working on with Congressman Nadler, who's the ranking member now on the Judiciary Committee, would say you can't remove children from their parents, but families have to be united. I mean, that's common sense and common humanity. Also, thank you. Also now, a court decision has come up, so at least they are now not dividing families, but that they are not, they don't know where the kids are, can you imagine? And I want to sort of close with one story that I think talks about the plight we have as a state and city. I think the worst thing that has come down to us is the so-called SALT provision that was in the tax bill that allows them to doubly tax New Yorkers. You're no longer able to deduct a your income from your what you pay in state and city taxes from your federal taxes. So in effect, New Yorkers will be double taxed to penalize. I tell the story because they are now sending a lot of these children to New York. So I ask, why are you sending children clear across the country from Texas to New York? And they say, well, it's because you have a foster care system that's well run and actually works. And that's probably because we pay taxes that allow us to give extra services to our people. So I am going to be working on a bill, hopefully with these two, that will say if you're a donor state and you pay more to the federal government than what comes back, which we are in spades, we are a donor state, then you cannot then tax that state again by not allowing their citizens to deduct the state and local taxes. So this is a huge challenge for us, and we have to take care of it. I do want to say that I love this island. It's one of the best community places. I always love all your festivals. I was here for Senior Day, and it was like a great big family. And Dick Moose's funeral, another beloved figure in our society. There are three main projects that I worked with you on. One was when there was crime, and also getting the connection for the Queens Roosevelt into 66th Street, the F line, I guess it is. Anyway, there was crime there. There was a woman who was raped, another who was stabbed, and some of you came to see me. And we got a federal grant to put in, I don't know if you know it, but they're really photographing what's happening in that subway all the time. There's a whole photographic system that goes into the police department. Crime has gone down. I'm very happy about that. Secondly, we saved the post office. Remember when they tried to say, take away the post office? They said, it's so near. Look at this map. This one's near. I said, but it's water. We want them to swim. You know, and we had to save the post office. And then many of you wanted a park. So now we have this beautiful park with the Four Freedoms Park that all of us worked on to enjoy. And I think that we'll be working on the second phase now with the Cornell University and the programming, and hoping that they are keeping their promises to engage the community. So I look forward to hearing your questions and projects that you would like us to attend to. I see people talking about Westview signs that are up there, and I think that working together, we need to make sure that Westview is held accountable in this process, and I'll be working with your state and local people on that. One of the questions is about the Supreme Court, and they say if a Democrat wins in 2020, would we be able to add two more seats? And that depends on the health of the justices. Kennedy is what, 89, I think? Anyway, so they decide when they want to retire. And so probably a Democratic president would make those decisions. And I got to tell you, the Supreme Court is so important. Some of our most major decisions come from the Supreme Court, not from Congress, because we can never agree. And I look at Brown v. Board of Education, Roe v. Wade. To this day, we could not pass Roe v. Wade in the United States Congress. And we now consider that settled law. So who goes on the Supreme Court? I'd say it's the most important decision that a president makes is the appointments to the Supreme Court. So that's critical. The helicopters over Roosevelt Island. This is a thorn in my side. When I was on the city council, there are too many accidents with these helicopters. Number one, I think we should ban any tourism things. They want to go up there and just fly around. You may need it, but business reasons, but have you noticed how many accidents we have in didn't know why they were crashing. So they're dangerous. They should not be flying over the island. And I think that I work as a team with my team here. We're all very lucky to have this team. They work so hard. And I know Rebecca Seawright's on her way, but Kallos and Senator Serrano, they do, and Rebecca Seawright, they really care about the island. It's a priority of all of ours that we work well together. So I think what we need to do, because since this is really a local bill, in fact, I passed a bill at one point that banned them when I was on the city council years ago, but it was ruled unconstitutional that we couldn't do it. I think we've got to revisit it collectively, because it is a city, state, and federal issue. And I'll bring the feds, they got to bring the city, but let's get back together in a month and have a meeting on the helicopters and get a joint plan moving forward to try to get rid of them. Because there's no reason for them to be flying over the island, and a lot of their accidents, they end up crashing into the water. And I always think, God forbid, that they did not crash into one of our populated buildings and kill people. So it's really too many accidents. It's every other day. We keep complaining about it. It keeps happening. So I think we've got to regroup again and hold them accountable and work as a team to do that. So is that a good plan? And would you come to the meeting and let them know how much you care about it? How much care about it? Thank you so much.
Thank you to our Congressmember for dropping in and answering questions. We will let her go so she can get on to the rest of the district.
Let me tell you, I'm going to a meeting with Lieutenant Governor Kathy Vogel. I regret that I'm only in town like one day a week. You know, because I'm in Washington, that's where my job is. That's my thrill to be here, and we'll plan another one on a Thursday night so I can be with you again. Please excuse me, I'm going to go back to work. Thank you for what you do to make this community so special.
On the question of the helicopters, there was a question of where do you report it? You can report it to 311. There are two types of helicopters that you will see in the sky. One of them will be an NYPD helicopter. 311 will pass that complaint onto NYPD if they determine that it was a police helicopter. And those helicopters are welcome wherever they need to be. The other is the Economic Development Corporation in the city. That is where those complaints will go. And we're happy to work with our Congress member because of the FCC, which has oversight over that item. And so I will now, we received a whole number of questions about democracy for Roosevelt Island. And so the person who has been sponsoring legislation on this since long before I was elected will speak on that topic. And we're just grouping a lot of the cards together. I'd say we have probably we had a lot of questions on that one.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Do you want me to read the whole question or just refer to the issue? Okay. So I have a couple of cards in front of me. Three out of the four are pretty similar, so I'll put that aside and do that in a second. One of the questions that I got is about the horrific situation with the young children who are separated at the border and are actually being housed in New York City, which is, for a lot of people, a very surprising situation. If children are being separated from their families at the border in Texas, which is horrific enough to think about, but then shipping the children alone, thousands of miles away to bring them to East Harlem in the South Bronx, it sort of compounds the pain when you consider what's happening. And I have to say, I as a father of two young children, it really pains me to see what is happening to these families. And I'm so concerned about the long-term implications to the mental health of these young children who are dealing with such a traumatic experience, probably already dealing with trauma and coming from their country. to the United States and dealing with the situations that they had back home. But then to be separated at such a young age, you don't need to be a child psychologist to know that the most important thing that you give your children when they're very young is a feeling of safety and a feeling of security. And if you're breaking them away from their parents, what you're doing is you're destroying all the underpinnings, all of the foundations of things that they have for their own strength. And it's just so disheartening to see that this has happened. And there are a number of children, I don't know the exact number because the federal government won't release this information, but we learned that there were a number of children being housed in East Harlem, in that part of my district, in the South Bronx. Different social service organizations were the ones that have contracts with the federal government, and the children were being sent many miles away to be there. I would ask, why so far? Why not keep them closer to where their parents are being processed for their asylum that they are seeking here in this country, which is their right to do? It is a right by law that those seeking political asylum are in imminent danger in their home country, that they can come to the border and seek asylum. Unfortunately, President Trump believes that these individuals need to be deported on the spot. But that is a violation of law, and it cannot happen. But what makes it so sad is that these children are here. We met with the social service providers. Congress member Esfayad organized a meeting with one of the providers, and I know that in the Bronx there were similar discussions and meetings to ensure that the children are being treated fairly and humanely and given all the things that they need. What really needs to happen in short order is reunification of these families. There should not be any extended separation. And you know, children have amazing coping skills. And as traumatized as they are, over time they will play, they will do things. But that only masks the scars that they are dealing with, the deep scars. And we have to be cognizant of that and make sure that they are given access to additional mental health screenings and things of that nature. So there are a number of children here, close to 300. We're doing all that we can to make sure that the president's new executive order to end separations at the border also includes timely reunification to undo this horrific, unjust situation. And I just have to say, this is not a political event, and I'm not speaking politics here, but there are things happening that I never thought I'd see in my lifetime. Things that a lot of my parents' generation fought for, civil rights, things that we took for granted, things that I thought we would never have to revisit, things that I believed were now ingrained into society as we know it here in America. And here we are, talking about separating people at borders, deporting them without any just cause or due process, banning travel based on race and ethnicity. I mean, these are things that just boggle my mind. And I have to quickly get over that because I can't sit here, you know, sad about this. The truth is we have to fight. And the way that we do it is by speaking our minds and by shining a light on this very big problem. All right, so that's the issue on this. I have three other cards here. Two of them ask myself and Assemblymember Seawright, my colleague in Albany, about the RIAC board appointments. This is a big issue. One of the things that I have been fighting for legislatively for many years is to ensure that the board appointments are more reflective of residents on the island, meaning that we have island residents who are on the RIAC board. This is just, you know, I'm a senator, I have to live in my district. You know, these are just the types of things that I believe makes sense for better government, for good governance in that sense. There are a number of vacancies or appointments that need to be re-upped, and we're waiting on that. There is you know, and this is an excuse, but the truth is there's a lot of dysfunction in Albany. In the state senate, we are at 31-31, meaning that we are at a complete standstill in trying to get certain things done in the state senate. I believe that come January, when we have a new senate seated, there will be some change in the sense that we can maybe move forward on a number of different issues, including board appointments. I will reach out once again, and I've spoken with the governor's staff in the past, but just to get some further clarity on what we can expect, and implore and push and continue to fight to make sure that we have proper representation. I will try to get that done as quickly as possible and report back to everyone about that. Another question that we have is in regards to RIA and not respecting the RIA resolutions that are passed. You know, I do think that it's important that RIA work hand in hand with the residents on the island. I think that's something that as an elected official, it's my responsibility to help facilitate that. But from my point of view, I can only speak for myself. I find as an elected representative, it is much better to have good dialogue with your community and listen to the concerns and do what the community is asking. It's not about one side or the other. It's about having the best governance structure for an island as unique as Roosevelt Island. It's that simple, yet it's complicated. So I think it's important that RIOC, in response to this question, be a good neighbor when it comes to listening to the concerns of the Roosevelt Island Residents Association. And I think, let me just make sure that I didn't neglect anything from this one here. This one is about board appointments. And this one is about approaching the governor's board appointments. Okay.
Just to follow up on the senator's work, the mayor has a certain number of appointments as well, and you better believe that that is something I brought to the mayor personally on multiple occasions, probably once a month, every month, for the past 54 months. I've also been asking people who work for the mayor, who grew up on Roosevelt Island, for their assistance as well while they were working with the mayor too. So I think for myself, our state senator, our assembly member, you have very strong advocates for democracy here on the island. We received some other quick questions. So we do have React here, and so one question, and actually let me, working with Roosevelt Island, there was advocacy for part of participatory budgeting for there to be a hearing loop at the Roosevelt Island Library. It didn't actually win, but it did catch the attention of the New York Public Library, which not only agreed to do it at this location on Roosevelt Island, but did it citywide. So that is one opportunity and instance of participatory budgeting right around the island from one resident's advocacy having a citywide impact. And along those lines, we got a question without a name associated, but I'm going to guess that it is the same person, which asks about whether or not there will be ADA looping at Blackwell. And so I hope that we will touch base. The other question was whether or not there could be a red bus stop going south across from the north bus stop for people living in Southtown, going to the tram or the train. So we will ask if we are going to touch base with those folks, and we have their information on the card what have you. I did not get a chance to do quick remarks, but I just wanted to talk about some of the things we've had a chance to do together over the past 4 years, and I will get back to some of the questions and answers, which I know is what you're here for. When I got elected, we fought for universal pre-K. Roosevelt Island, the Upper East Side got like 100 or something seats. We had hundreds, if not thousands. As of this coming year, we have, I believe, 2,574 children turning 4 next year. And we're on track for 900 seats. What we were able to do early on Roosevelt Island is the city said there was no need on the east side of Roosevelt Island. We made a list with the Roosevelt Island Parents Network And we actually have fulfilled the need, thanks in part, a huge part, to the Roosevelt Island Operative Corporation and the Bay Nursery. In terms of TSIS 217, we've been investing and working with them to make sure Cornell Tech follows through on their promise to adopt. And we've also invested $1 million with our state assembly member Rebecca Seawright and our borough president, who I think each did a $250,000 or $500,000 to do a green roof, which is moving forward. On the transportation front, the tram, believe it or not, is operating without a license from the city. We've approved at the city council a 50-year license, and we eagerly await the Department of Transportation and Freon settling and finalizing that 50-year agreement. Something that we've been working on for years is ferry service, and it was amazing to open that last summer. That was a pretty big deal. Federal and city elected officials are trying to get you a free transfer to the MTA. Something that you may remember from 2009 was I was working with the Roosevelt Island Residents Association on bringing bike share to Roosevelt Island. It's almost 10 years, but I still haven't given up, and I know that Rick from the Roosevelt Island blogger hasn't given up either, because every time I see him, he asks me about it. We got DOT to authorize City Bike to come to Roosevelt Island, and we're currently working with City Bike as well as REOC on moving forward with that, and we hope to have good news soon. And and there's a couple of questions on the MTA. We have a new head of the MTA named Andy Byford, who's amazing, and we'll be working with him on trying to make sure that we have F-Train service, and I got some questions in terms of new items. Another piece you may have noticed is that Roosevelt Island is a literary landmark. That's something we're able to do with funding from our office for the rich history here. Another thing that I actually take a lot of pride in is I have a tennis bubble across the street from the, across the river from the tennis bubble here. And the tennis bubble here is used by everybody on the island, regardless of socioeconomic income, regardless of race, regardless of ethnicity. And that's in large part because of the New York Junior Tennis League. It pretty much offers year-round free service. So I'm a huge fan of Joyce, which is short and all the great work that she does there. And I just wish we did it otherwise, because here on Roosevelt Island, you can play for free pretty much any time, like $30. Across the river, the city park, not the React Park, but the city park, it's $200 an hour. And so I think that's wrong. I think that's discriminatory. And I think Roosevelt Island is leading the way. In terms of Blackwell House, we were able to work with the Department of Cultural Affairs to get moving on that construction. We're grateful for React for their partnership there. We have a community emergency response team here on Roosevelt Island. We worked with them on doing go bag giveaways and recruiting events, and we're happy to come back again. We can have the CERT members please stand up briefly so we can thank them for their volunteering and all of their great work day in and day out. When we did have an instance of gun violence in my district here on Roosevelt Island, I asked experts, what do you do? They said, call a press conference. I went to public safety on the 114th, and they said, how about instead of a public press conference, we roll out the Police Explorers program here on the island. And I just want to thank Public Safety Department and their chief and 114 for doing mentorship and working with the students and doing the baseball leagues and what have you, and just really mentoring kids who might otherwise get in trouble without having adult role models and mentors and what have you. So we can thank our public safety folks for the 114. Petition from the React president, Susan Rosenthal, and her partner in crime, America, Spencer Yell, who's been trying to get this to be Art Island. I've done my fair share to try to help out. We now have a senior cultural program here on the island, but that's nothing compared to Blue Dragon, which was unveiled a couple of years ago, and recently, The Plinth, that you can visit on the way out. I just want to thank the Riva Gallery President Ted Sudol for keeping that space active and bringing it to us here. And in terms of Cornell Tech, we made it through the construction without the helix falling, and we lived through it. They did a lot of barging. They've now opened, and we're working with them. They've become great partners in the community. And I think one of the things we're concerned about is as they expand, traffic and people getting on and off the island. And we'll continue to work with them, Roosevelt Island Operating Corporation, and every single partner on the island to make sure that no matter how many people may be going to Cornell Tech, that it does not have a negative impact on the island, and in fact, they spend their money here and support local businesses and local jobs right here on the island. So that was my quick report. One of the questions was, can the elected officials here, so that's the state and city and federal, we all have oversight over the MTA, work on getting a rush hour express bus to Manhattan from Roosevelt Island. I'm happy to, the person didn't put their name here, but please touch base with our offices. I'm interested in talking to you. I'll be honest. Sometimes it used to be faster to take a cab here than wait on that train that might not show up. I will tell you now that it takes, according to Google Maps, and it's never quite right, but it's faster to get here by train from the Q to the F and from the F to other lines than by bus or even cab, but we're interested in working with you. The other question is about Q102 service. I'm interested in working with our other elected officials, and we don't. So we do have a name here, so we don't have your contact information. So if the person who gave us the card on the Q102 and other people are interested in working with us, we need your eyes and ears to let us know when the service isn't up to par so we can work with you and MTA to make sure that it is properly running. I want to invite from the Public Advocate's Office, Jennifer Greer, to just join us on this panel. Another question we got is whether or not we can build a staircase and elevator from Roosevelt Island to the 59th Street Bridge. My grandfather used to work on Roosevelt Island and take the elevator here. I like the idea. I'm interested in working with folks who've been reaching out and working with benefactors at Cornell Tech and otherwise. So I, for one, would be in favor of working with you if this is something that is important to the community. I'll see if anyone else wants to comment on that one. Another thing that we'll just flag for our Congress member and as part of the working group is folks are also concerned about seaplanes flying over Roosevelt Island, so we will deal with that. So I think that we've gotten a lot of questions. I think I will turn it over to all the way for Rebecca Seawright, who we do have for legislative director and council, Rebecca Graham. We've got an inordinate amount of questions on Westview, as well as on metering. I would say at least 20. And we all work as a team, and I can tell you that even if whoever your point of contact is on any of these issues, we're always working together, but we know that the face of this issue and one doing a lot of upfront work and meeting with people is Rebecca Grant from Rebecca Seawright's office. So we will turn to her to answer those questions while we're here. The assembly member that comes to make the larger report. So she'll talk about Westview as well as sub-metering.
Good evening. Good evening. My name is Rebecca Graham, and I'm legislative counsel to Rebecca Seawright. Assembly member Seawright will be arriving later this evening. I'm happy to be here. I see many familiar faces that I've worked with for the past 5 years. With regard to Westview, we understand the seriousness of Westview. And we've had meetings held in our office with senior officials from DHCR, with RIA. We are in constant contact and communication with the various agencies that are involved. It's a high priority. The assembly member speaks to the commissioner on this very issue, and we are confident that it will be resolved. And I understand, the Assembly member understands your frustrations with the continuing delay. With regard to individual questions about Westview, there were some questions here about transferring apartments. Sarah, who's sitting in the audience here, she is my assistant. And if you can go to her, she has index cards, and you can put your contact information, your specific questions, and we will contact you tomorrow, next week, with specific responses for specific individuals. With regard to sub-metering, I have personally worked on that issue with the Assembly member and had a very successful outcome a few years ago. We again have been having meetings in our office with regard to sub-metering. We are promoting complete transparency in the process. And again, the Assembly member is working very hard to protect the residents of Roosevelt Island. As many of you know, legislative session in Albany ended last week. Assembly members strike passed numerous bills, including a bill related to air quality. This bill would require, it passed the Assembly, would require that the Commissioner of the Department of Environmental Conservation promulgate rules and regulations for air monitoring equipment at all waste transfer stations. As you know, 91st Street, MTS, even though it's on the other side of the river, that air is going to come right over to Roosevelt Island. Also, the Assembly member fought very hard and was successful in the budget this year for the Department of Health to conduct an asthma study for Manhattan and to provide recommendations. And these two things are combined because asthma, we know, is caused partially by bad air quality. Also, she's very successful in the budget this year, a $25 million payment that was owed to Roosevelt Island related to Cornell Pedion. That was also included in the budget this year. Senator Serrano is a great partner to the Assembly member. We work closely, I work closely with the staff in Albany. And these things don't happen without a group effort. Courtney Farisee is our director of constituent services, and she is in the back with a team of interns. She will be. Which one? Courtney is in the back with our team of interns. Courtney, can you wave? She was here yesterday for constituent hours, and she will be back on July 11th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Do not hesitate to call Courtney or our office at 212-288-4607. And of course, this is a issue that we have worked closely with Joyce Short on with regard to defining consent with regard to sexual encounters. And as we all know, with the Me Too movement, this is the time for this type of legislation and attention. And Joyce has been very helpful in assisting us. There's also many of these questions here are from people that I have spoken to directly, the Fullertons. Are you guys here? Hi. They hosted the Assembly member, C. Wright, a few years ago and addressed the issues of Westview and the senior concerns. There's Ofer. Ofer was here from the Westview Task Force, as well as some other. There's Ofer. And there's some. Say hello. Johan. And we. We work closely, not only with the Rescue Task Force, but we also work closely with people who feel their concerns are not always addressed by the Rescue Task Force. The Assembly member, she represents all of the interests, not just us individual promotion. Also, we, before coming here tonight, I spoke with RIAC, and they have assured me that once the deal is finalized, they will do an emergency session meeting on Rescue. There is no conspiracy here.
When did they do it?
Excuse me?
When?
They said it could be done once the deal is finalized.
So I just want to thank everyone for working with us on the cart. If folks have additional questions, we are actually running low, so raise your hand, we'll bring you palm card, we'll bring you the index cards to get you, we'll collect additional ones. I had a chance to look through some of the cards. One of the questions was asked about for other building related tenants associations. If you're having trouble having your tenants association recognized, you have a First Amendment right, it was correct to peaceably assemble. And if they are trying to be frustrated or whoever your landlord is, we can work with you. We can work with the landlord and make sure that you're recognized and that they're not hearing your concerns. We're happy to pass it on as well. That being said, our preference is to just try to make sure you get the questions in, make sure your information's on the back. But we want to keep the discourse civil. There was a question that was asked that I think you tried to answer, but you were being drowned out. I thought it was clear, but if you want to get your moment, of course.
That's not discourse. Be fair. Being told something, I'm not responding to a question. It's not discourse. It's not a dialogue here. You guys are talking about what you want to talk about. We're here because we're concerned for our family, for our life, for our home, that has 25 years.
Fully understands and recognizes and is well aware of how important the Westview issue is. And Westview is the last building to exit the Chalama, and sometimes it just isn't happening as fast as we all would like. But we have been assured, we speak to all the agencies on a regular, continuous basis. We speak to RIAC, we speak to the task force, and we are assured that this will happen in timely, and RIAC has told us that once the deal is finalized, that they can do a meeting in 3 days.
What are the costs?
Two years.
It's frustrating.
The roadblock. So, Susan, where are
you? So I just want to add one other thing, because we work as a team. So the mayor of the city of New York said he was going to build affordable housing. He said he was going to do 300,000 units of affordable housing. Early on, I actually went to the mayor and I said, on Roosevelt Island, we are hemorrhaging affordable housing like nobody's business. Will you do a deal to protect thousands of units here? We sat down with the Housing Preservation and Development. We put as much pressure. We sat down with the Speaker of the City of New York, and the response we got on the city level from HPD, from the mayor, was that Roosevelt Island was a state-run place and that it was solely DHCR. And I don't think that's an acceptable answer. So just one of the things that we could do is, if you're interested in advocating with HPD and the mayor, to say that you are a New York City resident, you vote for the mayor, and regardless of whether or not things are you have RIAC doing local services or not, we can put pressure on the mayor and HPD to step up to the plate to provide additional support beyond the HCR. So I feel a little, we thought we've gotten our answer. It doesn't mean we have to take no for an answer, but I just want to thank some members here at the State Senator Serrano, because they've been leading the fight where the city has advocated in a way that I haven't seen the mayor do in any other location. So I just want to thank them for their advocacy working with the HCR and RIAC.
This is not transparent. You talk about transparency.
assembly member will have a chance to join us. But as we had said before, our borough president, Gail Brewer, tends to make it to everything and anything. We're grateful to have her here.
Thank you very much, Ben Kallos, and congratulations to everybody. And the number one issue in New York is the lack of affordable housing. So I appreciate everybody here from Westview because it is a topic that I care deeply about. I just want to say a couple of things that I know you may have covered some of them. One of them, which is just fun, as you know, every year we have a senior food program, fresh fruits and vegetables. And I just want to let you know it's $8 for every bag. It's very popular on Roosevelt Island. And the first date is going to be July 11th. And you can just call the Roosevelt Island Senior Center and it goes all the way until the end of October. It was $8 for a $20 value and it's all fresh fruits and vegetables. And I want to thank everybody who participated in the past. I think you're number one in the whole Manhattan in terms of being participants. So I appreciate it. And then, you know, the other issue, the library, I assume you've already discussed. I spoke to the DDC commissioner this morning and asked them why in the world it's taking so long. But my understanding, and I'm sure you heard this of others, is that it is absolutely going to cost a fortune. $8.6 million up from $5.5 million, but somehow the capital money arrived between the mayor and the library, so it is paid for, and it will be done by the end of 2019, and that's taken a very long time to get started, but apparently they got kicked off yesterday in terms of the process. So thank you for all your advocacy, because you have been a great advocate for this library, and your tax money of $8.6 million is going to make it a beautiful library, and along the way, I hope if you have more ideas, you let us know. Thank you very much for what you did for the Cat Sanctuary Water issue. You were very successful. Congratulations. And then I think all the other issues that you have, you know, between the tram and the elevator and all the other topics you may have already brought up and the ferry double charge, particularly for folks on Roosevelt Island, that is an outrage. We're going to continue to work together. You have a great, wonderful group of elected officials. And we will continue to work together. And I think there are other topics, and I'll try to answer questions. I'm sorry to be late, but I already did three events between now and 5 o'clock. Thank you very much.
So, do we have any additional cards?
I have some questions that didn't get answered on my card at all. Regarding Manhattan Park, actually, it's Northtown Phase 2 because they did not recognize us as part of their complex. We are affordable housing also, and they haven't even told us if they're going to renew the contract with HUD, which will keep us affordable. Also, they discriminate against us all the time. They have submetering there, and they're profiting off of the submetering. It seems like no one will help us. We've contacted Ben Kallos' office many times. Have not gotten responses. We invited you to attend meetings. You have never come.
He was up in Washington last week.
We've reached out to other people.
That's right.
And it seems like our voices aren't being heard. Maybe because we're labeled as just low-income tenants, so they don't care about us. But we're working-class people, too, that have also lived on Roosevelt Island for decades. And it isn't fair that we constantly get ignored on Roosevelt Island. You know, we matter too, our children matter too, our families matter too. So I think that we should get some type of recognition because they don't even call us Manhattan Park. Last week, they won't even let us form a tenant association. Last week, they had a tenant appreciation barbecue and they didn't even invite us. I put up a sign in the hallway in the lobby telling everyone to come. They ripped the signs down and finally decided to invite us to the tenant appreciation barbecue the day before. And that's only because I made the tenants of North China Phase 2 aware that there was a tenant appreciation day. So, I mean, who's going to help us? Who's going to stand up for us? And even when she talked about submetering, she did part, which are clearly put on me. So it's like, we're not even being acknowledged. We are here too, and maybe we need to make a stronger presence known, and we will, but you know, it's not fair.
Well, I'll turn it back over to the councilor in a minute, but I just want to respond and thank you for bringing that question up. You know, you should not be ignored, and the building is not allowed to not let the tenants organize. That's a fundamental right in the environment.
We're not a
real
tenant.
Yeah,
we do not have
community. Well, I would like to have a look into that. Because
they opened up to Washington. We know there's new advocates out here, and it feels like it's supposed to be 50 years of the Poor People March campaign, but to me it feels like 1968. And what gets me upset about the draw, I'm the one, a lot of us go around voting for y'all, because the young people will not vote. We are the ones who vote for this one, but I feel so insecure, I don't know who I'm going to vote. I don't know what's going to happen, but we don't give up, okay? And it's wrong, because take to yourself, one day, it's going to happen to somebody you know, and happen to real close.
It does, and I appreciate what you're saying, because it's absolutely right. There is, from a broader point of view, there is a serious crisis with affordable housing in general. If you look at my district, which covers the South and West Bronx, East Harlem, Yorkville, the West Side, Roosevelt Island, if you look at what has happened over the last 15 years to affordability, and this isn't just building luxury houses and not building affordability. This is about the aging out of Mitchell-Lama as we know it. Nowhere in the years that we had Mitchell-Lama housing, knowing that it was going to sunset, that was not a mystery, that did not take anyone by surprise. Yet and still, there was no governmental fortitude to create a Mitchell-Lama 2.0 that would create or preserve that level of affordable housing for working class New Yorkers, as the Mitchell-Lama program was very effective.
We're not Mitchell-Lama. No,
I'm talking
about Section 8 project based, and that's the problem, is that it's a lot, it was Mitchell-Lama, but no one ever talks about Section 8 project based, and that is an issue too.
Well,
we deserve to stay here also,
right?
Just because we're not in a certain bracket, but we work too. We may not be making thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars, but we work very hard, and we've been here for a long time, and we want our kids to be in a safe neighborhood also.
Right, and I agree with you. Section 8 is one of those issues where, in many ways, the federal government has turned their back on a program that was a lifeline for a lot of seniors, a lot of residents to be able to live in their homes. What we have with the loss or the lack of expansion of programs like Section 8 is you have less and less diversity in the housing stock, you have less economic diversity. So you're creating much more segregated neighborhoods. And segregation is a thing, like I said at the beginning of my comments, things that I thought we would never have to revisit. But these, when you have governmental policies that are not addressing inclusionary tactics, and by not speaking up for a tenants association, frowning upon tenants organizing, not giving due process to people who have Section 8 screen, other affordability issues, what you're doing is you're stratifying our society in a much deeper way. So I understand, I hear you 100%. I would like to learn more about specifically what's happening where you are, and I would like to get my office. One other thing, because I know you talked about subleasing, am I correct? You know, I have a bill. I have a bill that would require rent reduction equal to the amount of the additional charge for utilities for tenants in the building, which converts the sub-meter into utilities. And this is an important, I think, balancing factor. Yes? Yes.
I just want to say, in terms of
that's what they're already doing.
Can I just say, having lots of experience with Project Base. Why don't we get cards over here, we'll get your information, we'll all join in our meeting at the building with you. And to be honest, I hate to say this, but Section 8 might be a little bit easier to deal with even than Mid-Tawana. So we can work with you, it's city, it's state, it's federal, but I'm just saying, we've done it before. So we'd be glad to meet you.
Okay, we're just asking that we get help.
No, we can help.
That's why we do the town halls, and we have amazing staff that do great work, and occasionally we're still not satisfied, and that's why we're here, to make sure you have us. We work with organizations like tenants and neighbors that will come from our offices, and they can work with you on organizing and getting recognized, and we have your back to make sure that you get recognized. Then just in terms of the folks from Westview, my understanding is you're in communication with your app, they're here, they're hearing what you have to say. You have multiple folks who work there, including the president, and I think it was Rebecca Graham from the Rights Office said, and I think she hears you loud and clear. I know that our assembly member is on the way, so and she's asking for folks to stay so she can come and personally address you on these issues. What I've heard and what I believe Rebecca tried to clearly communicate is that they're negotiating, they're getting closer and closer to trying to have a deal. I understand it has taken a long time. I understand people would like to know exactly what's being negotiated. And so I think we can hear the concerns, and I know that we are present here and listening as is her staff. We have the Westview and other folks specifically for things from Rebecca Seawright's office. Are there any other specific questions? I also want to take a moment to welcome Michael Stinson from Controller Scott Stringer's office to join us up on the panel. So any non-housing related specific questions? Yes.
I've been to so many rallies that I have a pot in the whole year. But yes, I will be there, and I've been to the Cayuga Center to meet with the social workers. I've been to a couple of press conferences outside of the center, and it's a process, but yes, I'll be one.
I just want to address their 7 meter issue because we did in 2015 when I was working with the assembly members, we worked with the Manhattan Borough's office and Senator Tonano's office and were successful on a 7 metering issue where there was no additional charge for the cost of electricity for persons under the affordability plan. We are confident that that is going to be the way forward on more recent 7 metering issues. Also, we had a meeting in our office specifically on the latest 7 metering, and we can talk about that individually over on the side. Like I said, Sarah's here. Sarah and I are going to stay here as long as anyone wants to stay, and we will take individual names and individual contact information, and we will address your concerns.
If you're not here from Westview, you want to thank you for then we will reconvene as soon as she gets here. You will have the assembly member here and her staff. We'll be there. She'll be here talking about. So I just want to thank everyone for coming out, and we will see you at all the mobile hours, all the fun events this summer, and always, we always have the account.
I have Laura here and little one. Okay.
She worked here. Absolutely. That was a great one. The 97.1.
I have a card here.
Yeah, there was.